Come on, man!
Oh.
Do things!
I'm doing stuff.
Play video games!
Killing myself.
Great. Yeah, that was great. At this point, I'm just not even surprised anymore. She's like, yeah, no, this game is held together with duct tape and gum. You know?
I mean, it'd be fun if it was still fun.
Yeah.
I mean, all games have flaws. You remember fucking the original Smash Bros?
Yeah.
That game has its flaws.
Does it?
Yeah.
I always thought it was a pretty solid fighting game, even by today.
I mean, yeah, but there are certain things that you can do.
Like
you
what?
Make it crash, remember that?
Well, okay, those are just glitches, though. Like, that's fine.
Yeah.
This is not glitches so much as, like, a game held together with duct tape and glue. This is, like, the bare minimum to make the game presentable. You know what I mean?
No.
Like, shit. I'm saying, maybe put a buffer of extra, like, objects and textures underneath the world so that when you zoom in the camera nice and close, or when it snaps close after you ground pound on something that moves, it doesn't show you the fucking skeleton of the world underneath. Alright, here's my review of Fire Emblem Awakening on 3DS. I haven't finished the game, though, so it's not actually a review. I wouldn't even call it a first impression, because now I'm, like, almost 20 hours into the game.
Well, you know.
So, it's well beyond... It's an educated opinion without completing the game.
There you go.
So, this is my... Just to let you guys know, this is my first Fire Emblem game.
Official.
Yeah, whatever.
You've played Heroes.
I'm not counting that. That's not, like, an actual full campaign game.
Sure it is. Got the second book not too long ago.
It's really cool because I now kind of have a measurement of what a Fire Emblem game is supposed to play like. And Fire Emblem Heroes is actually pretty accurate to how a normal Fire Emblem game plays, which I'm happy about. So the way it works is you have all your team on the grid and you can move them all a certain amount of ways. They all have customizable classes, stats, in some ways, abilities, equipment, things like that. And you outfit them like you would any other tile-based strategy game, and you move them along the grid. When two opposing units meet, they fight. You get a preview screen of what each attack will do, its accuracy, crit chance, so you kind of have a preview as to the risk behind moving forward with the attack you've selected by moving to the unit you've selected. You basically just have all your units on one side of the screen, the enemies are on others or scattered, you know, and last one standing wins, basically. Plays out much like, you know, the only other real gauge I have of something familiar is Final Fantasy Tactics Advance and Fire Emblem Heroes. And, you know, of those two games I played, it basically just plays like a mixture of those two, really. Which is really fun and really great. There's a couple new mechanics that I'm not privy to, with it being my first Fire Emblem game, so things like the relationship system and the support systems and stuff like that is really cool. I like the effect it has on the story in the second half of the game. That's the kind of stuff that's really makes it kind of engaging, right? Because you kind of grow attached to all these different characters, and you kind of want to see them interact with one another. For those of you who have actually watched things like my old Animation Cells videos before that whole series fell through because of copyright being a bitch on YouTube, I kind of would compare it to kind of the way I worded my life as a teenage robot and the way Rob Renzetti does his characters, where he kind of puts them in this virtual dollhouse with no real care for the canon of their characterizations and things like that. And he just makes them interact in meaningful and fun ways that are fun to watch. And that's kind of the way Fire Emblem Awakening is. I'm not going to say that any of the characters are particularly well characterized, really, because they're meant to be slightly more filled in blank slates, so that you can just ship them all. Basically, with whoever you want.
Yeah, exactly.
Essentially. So that's kind of what makes it really interesting, though, just because it's just a novel concept that I've never really seen done to the extent it has in a game, and the way it like affects gameplay and stuff. And a lot of the maps are just fun, the strategy's fun, there's a lot of things you can do on the boards and stuff, pairing up units and stuff, so it's a good time. I would say that the story is nothing to write home about. I wouldn't say it's a bad story either. It's just kind of there, and it does its job at setting the tone for what you should be doing. But I'm having a lot of fun with it. I have Donald and you know, usual Crom and Robin. Nice dude. I've got a bunch of others. I've got, what's her name? Shersh or whatever. Shersh? Shershi?
Cersei?
I don't know. It was C-H-E-R-C-H-E. I think it's Shersh.
Probably.
Well,
there's voice acting in the game, so don't they?
Yeah.
Shit, I need a reminder.
A little bit. There's something. Oh, that's cool. It's like, it looks like a bigger sonar now.
Continue.
I mean, not a whole lot more to continue with. I don't want to give spoilers on the story and everything. I guess for those of you who care, I mean, especially with like Smash Bros and stuff and how popular that is, I now see like the game that like Lucina debuted in. Yeah, I don't think you're supposed to climb on those things. And it's kind of cool to see her arc, I guess. She's not really characterized the way I expected her to be characterized. She's much more childish than I assumed she was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because she is like a literal child. So actually I'll delve into one detail. So it's potentially spoilery, but I'm guessing everyone who's wanted to play at this point is probably okay. So in the second half of the game, Lucina brings up how much younger she is than Crom, being in the current timeline.
Yes.
Coming from the future, she's like, "Wow, father, you're like way younger," or whatever, right?
Mm.
It's many times speculated that it's at least a decade in the future she comes from. But in the current time, like, Lucina exists, but she is like a baby, like still like an infant wrapped in a towel.
Yes, at that point in time, yes.
So they're guesstimating through the dialogue that Lucina is maybe 11 or 12 years old. What the fuck? She can't be.
That's
Or she's from further in the future than that. I don't know. Maybe there's a bit of dialogue I haven't hit yet in the game where they specify exactly how far from the future she is. But they're saying at least a decade right now. So if they're like eyeballing.
Okay, well they're just saying it at the very least.
At the least. But how are you coming up with such a ridiculous least estimate of 11 or 12 years old?
Well, remember, they are basing it off, like, you know, the styles and stuff based on European times.
I guess.
And the age expectancies at that point were a lot different than they are for us now.
Yeah.
Remember, people in Greece used to be married around, like, 14, and their life expectancy at best was, what, 40?
Yeah. No, I guess you're right. It's just weird.
It is weird to think
about. It's just, I don't know. I'm sure, or maybe it's just a localization thing. Maybe, like, it was just wrongly translated to actually being longer than that.
Maybe, but I feel...
That's also possible.
I feel like Fire Emblem does a lot better with the translation stuff.
Yeah.
Than they do with any... most other companies.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I mean, for the most part, it's a very... dialogue... heavy game, is it not?
Ish. Not really.
No?
Nah. I mean, it's like, you know, you get like two lines of fairly sized dialogue per text box. The form factor just doesn't really allow for a lot of dialogue to happen. Okay.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. I'm glad you paid attention to the directions here.
Ah. I was just slow, that's all.
You don't know the trick. What are you supposed to be doing? You gotta race those things? I guess so.
Yeah.
Cool. I don't like these talking shopping carts. They're kind of gross to me. They've got like, see this like the seat flapping around?
Hello.
I don't like that. Or whatever. Staff at Platonic would be calling them trolleys right now, I guess.
Yeah, they would.
Watch out, oh my god. Dude, just go, oh my god.
I am.
Okay. Yep, you sure did.
Ah!
That's ridiculous, what the hell?
I think there's a bit of a trick, too. I think I got a trick.
I mean, I don't think there's a trick, I think it's just a predefined order they're moving in. Isn't it?
Maybe, I'm gonna try something.
I don't think they're following you.
No, but I mean, like, I have to... Oh, Here, we'll see if I'm right or not. Like, see how this spot sort of ends here?
Yeah.
One that activates here. What I'm thinking is I have to go, like, oh, that just fucking completely changed.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I think it's just a predefined order.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Just a predefined set of behaviors it has. Ooh. Yeah, that's good.
Well, I'll have to say to that.
I don't get why. I guess you're kind of doing this right now. I won't split your concentration. But I assume it's fun. I've been hearing nothing but fun things.
It is a lot of fun.
That's good.
I mean, like, essentially, Monster Hunter, I always look at it as just like a big boss rush kind of game. You face these large, varied monsters, and they all have their own different patterns and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And just the detail in them, I really enjoy it a lot. Hey!
See?
Didn't see that?
I friggin' called it!
Got what?
That you're gonna get a power where you just stick out your tongue and you start pulling things around.
I was like, why the fuck can't I jump?
You have to let go.
Yeah. Well, see? I didn't realize.
Yeah, that. See? Man! Okay. So, yeah. I was right, it just, you didn't have the power for it yet. Oh my god.
It's fine, man.
No, it's not. Sure nothing it about this is fine.
Ow. I can fucking see him.
I mean, if it's any consolation, this goes to show you what quality of game.
Hey!
I don't think that was intended either.
Nope.
Good lord. Alright, cool.
I hope everyone's taking notes.
Yeah, I mean, you're just bugging your way through this game right now.
Damn right.
I guess this.
You hear that, game devs?
Look,
don't be afraid to
yeah.
have me play test.
Yeah, really. Ooh, there you go. This game shows, like, unfortunately, on the other side of things, playing devil's advocate to the tone I've been taking throughout this game. This certainly goes to show you the kind of shoddy product you'll still get even after having, like, upwards of 3.5 to 4 million US dollars as your budget.
Yeah.
Like, this is a large-scale indie game. Like,
yes,
large scale.
It's one of the few that got so much money.
And one half of it is, you know, the talent behind it, whether or not that creates some issues. But the other half of it is just the plain old budget of it and showing you, you know, even though you have seven figures, this is still what can happen to your game.
Yep.
You know? Budget can help, but I don't know. I don't know if lack of budget was the problem here, or if this goes to show that even a bigger budget can't save you from this stuff. And it all comes down to the talent. It's a weird toss-up between what's at fault here. Because it really could be both. The realistic answer lies between two extremes at all times, you know? So, I guess the answer is that it's probably both.
I can't give you the answer. You'd have to ask someone from Playtonic.
I don't think they'd be comfortable answering that.
No, they wouldn't.
Oh! Because that's the other thing, they don't listen to criticism very well. Dude, you can't do that!
Well, I don't know why the fuck you won't let me grapple that.
Because you're hurt and you're in the swampy waters. There we go. Or, I don't know, it's probably just spotty.
It's definitely spotty.
I'll still stand by, like, as far as actual level layout and stuff, I would say that this is probably the strongest so far. I'll give it that. Like, this is at least platforming, and you're not just running around empty, wide-open spaces. Oh, that's good.
Okay, that one might actually be my fault.
Is it maybe you can't actually grapple onto it while you're jumping and doing it?
No, I think I just wasn't close enough for that time.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, you're right.
Nope!
Okay.
That's
bull. I'm thinking there's a trick to it. Because that's always what it is, with these, like, quirky kind of mechanics. People always say they don't work, but it's more so they just work in a very particular way. I'm wondering if maybe... Weird. Is there a specific order? That wouldn't make any sense. Nothing to do with the light color on the things, like those light colors on the grapple points don't change, right?
Don't think so. Here, let me just some more butterflies.
Yeah, sure. If we're gonna kind of like go into like like my favorite levels from these sorts of games. I always like the ones that have like those points of intrigue at the center of them. Whether it's a, like a big landmark or like just something interesting like that.
Little subtle details.
You need some, yeah, you kind of need like some sort of standout detail that separates it from the other levels. Otherwise they start feeling samey, right? Like what I always liked about Banjo-Tooie and Banjo-Kazooie alike were that they kind of nailed that really well. Because like if you really boil down in a reductionist way to what Banjo-Kazooie and Tooie are is, it's just you're running around in just really big levels that don't really have a whole lot going on in them. But there's like little goals just placed throughout the big worlds, right? Mm. So you actually have a lot of downtime between the actual gameplay in those games. But it's the intrigue toward going toward those points that still kind of what fuels you.
Also, did you notice that I made it to that platform this time?
I did actually. But it's, oh geez.
Yeah, no, that was my fault. I didn't press the jump button again. Being dumb.
This seems like bullshit. They're basically, so there's four of them, right?
Yep.
So they're basically, it should take you on average about 6 seconds per section to do this then. Wow, yeah, they do not give you a lot of time with that then. There you go. I think you got it that time. Yeah.
Just barely.
That they give you like just barely enough time to do that.
Yay, oh, I can just do. Well, that's cool. So you can. I was kind of wanting a pagey, but.
Okay. Do you think that there's a? Do you think there's a little puzzle put everywhere throughout the worlds that'll remove all the swamp water eventually?
I think it'll be some.
See, again, that's another thing. Like that's kind of what I was saying with like every level needs its own little gimmick or point of interest. That to me is cool.
You know what that kind of reminded me of?
Hmm.
For no reason. You remember Majora's Mask? How it was all poisonous swamp water, and after you beat the dungeon, yeah, it turned to normal?
Yeah.
Yeah, it kind of reminded me of that.
That's but not no reason.
Not quite as fun.
That's not no reason, I understand that. No, I think that this seemed more fun building up to it than Majora's Mask. Majora's Mask, you go on a fucking camera tour. And then you stab a giant octopus.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
that part of it. Yeah, sure, you can.
That's
say it's boring.
That's lame.
I mean, that's lame. That's kind of lame. I'm talking about the dungeon and stuff.
Oh yeah, I mean it does its job. It's the first one. It just kind of teaches you basic layouts and stuff.
Plus, it has Adalwa, and who doesn't love Adalwa?
Adalwa is ridiculous.
I mean, he is ridiculous.
He just dances around. And he runs around real fast.